Randy.
All right, this is Police Chief Jim Corwin just walked into the room. Some of the people we just described earlier to you are at the back of the room. Jim Knatzer is here. Mark Folsom is here. Lyndon Netzler is here, along with some other folks from the law enforcement authorities. And there are a number of city council folks here, including Police Commissioner Al Brooks.
On Wednesday afternoon at about 4 p.m., officers arrested a 52-year-old Bernard Jackson after a short foot chase. Jackson was inside a house in the 3200 block of Thompson. A friend saw him, and an officer saw him walk out of the rear door of the house. When Jackson saw the officer, he fled on foot and was taken into custody in the 3200 block of Smart. Jackson was developed as a person of interest in a Waldo rape investigation through good detective work, using information and evidence gathered during the investigation. While investigating Jackson, detectives linked him to four unsolved Kansas City rapes from the 1980s. While Jackson is considered a person of interest in the Waldo rapes, additional investigation is necessary before he can be charged with those crimes. Detectives are still following leads in the case and analyzing the evidence. During the course of the investigation, we received nearly 1,000 tips. Detectives have logged several thousand hours investigating leads. While our work is not done, I want to take this time to thank the community for their support and commend them for pulling together during this difficult time. I also want to commend the detectives, the police officers, and the prosecutors who have worked very hard on this case. And now I'd like to turn this over to Jackson County Prosecutor Jim Knatzer.
Thank you, Chief Corwin. Good afternoon, everyone. As in all criminal cases, all defendants are presumed innocent until proven guilty in a court of law. I have charged Bernard Jackson today with four counts of robbery in the first degree, five counts of sodomy, and six counts of rape. Bernard Jackson is facing up to 15 life sentences for these counts. These charges are alleged to have occurred between July of 1983 through February of 1984. All charges are alleged to have occurred in the Waldo and Armor Hills areas of Kansas City, Missouri. These charges were possible in large part due to forensic DNA technology. I would like to thank the Kansas City, Missouri Police Department, Chief Corwin, its cold case unit, sex crimes unit, and its laboratory for the manner in which they have prepared this case for prosecution. Their skill and professionalism in performing their duties has been outstanding.
This time we'll take your questions.
Done before any charges would come in the current Waldo situation, what we're referring to as a Waldo rapes investigation. Are you confident charges will happen in that with in connection with Mr. Jackson?
At this particular time, we're working that case up for basically the filing and presenting that to the prosecutor. I don't.
Mr. Knatzer, were you able, sir, to obtain the forensic evidence and the chemical evidence that you just referred to on the charges after Mr. Jackson was taken into custody yesterday? Is that when you were able to make the matches?
These cases were worked primarily. One of them was identified prior to the arrest of Bernard Jackson, but they were worked after he was developed as a person of interest in this case.
Did some of that happen after he was taken into custody yesterday?
The DNA technology and the samples, I think, that you were referring to, no, those were not obtained yesterday. Are you referring to the modern cases?
Yes.
Okay, I'm not going to comment on that as it's a pending investigation.
No, sir, since those cases have not been charged yet, can we assume that DNA evidence has not yet been developed in those cases?
You can assume that the Kansas City, Missouri Police Department is going to use all the technology that's available to them towards the investigation of this case.
Jim, can you tell us, this guy had been on parole since 08. Jim Corwin,
Jim.
Sorry. Police Chief Corwin. Can you tell us, this guy had been on parole since 08. Is there any particular reason that you know of why no one else in the system, the parole officers, anyone who had contact with this man, did not identify him as a suspect any sooner in this case?
No, I can't comment on the system, no.
Chief, can you comment? What is it about Waldo? Both these cases are all concentrated in the Waldo area. The current case is being investigated, concentrated basically in the same area. Do we know why? I mean, can you shed any light about why this particular neighborhood?
Don't think so. I think that what we're seeing that down, I think we'll have a map for you in a little bit, but I can't answer that question. I don't know, other than the fact it's a residential area.
Can you describe for us what led you to him yesterday? What was the process that happened once you got on the ground there? How long was the foot chase, those sorts of things?
We're not going to comment too much on yesterday's case. Right now, it's like right now we're putting together that case file, and we're not going to comment on that.
I'm just talking about how you caught him yesterday.
Again, we're not going to be talking about the specifics right now.
Chief, at one point, Detective Folsom went over to the city council and said, you know what, folks, we need a break. We'll get a break. Can you talk at all about what that break was?
Not this time.
That development that then led you to these older cases. How long ago did you become aware that he may be connected to these cases?
I'd like to be able to talk about that at this time, but I can't.
Chief, should there be some kind of comfort level among people who live in the Waldo area and around it? Although the charges today are from the past, should there be some comfort level for them? Can you give them some sort of hope?
I think anytime we take a person off the street that's good for those kinds of crime, I think everybody should feel a little comfortable about that.
Chief, what's the status of the reward in the current case? Is that still available? Do you need tips in the current investigation? Or has a tip provided, will a tip that has already been provided result in the reward?
I don't know what's going on at the Crime Commission right now, but certainly we would encourage anybody that has information to come forward.
Can you talk about the 83 cases and why they were not solved at that time? What happened with those cases? Have those just been cold cases sitting there?
They have been cold cases, yes.
Sir, can you tell us, I'm sorry, I just forgot those answers.
Can you elaborate on Chris's question there about the series of cases from 83 and early 4? Was that considered a serial rape situation then?
Mark Folsom, Captain Folsom, would you like to talk about that?
I believe, not being around in 84, but my understanding is that we were aware that we had a pattern back then, and they didn't have the DNA technology that we currently have today. And our cold case unit, sex crimes cold case, was able to work up those cases using the arrangement that we have with the Jackson County Prosecutor's Office and our crime lab. We've developed a protocol that's yielded some very good results.
The four victims from the 80s, and what are they saying about the charges being filed?
Yes, we have, and they're very cooperative, very relieved to have some closure in the case for them. It's been a long time for them, and they, like I said, they were excited when we gave them the initial phone call and said we may have a suspect, and you know, will you cooperate with us and continue with prosecuting those cases? And then when we called them today to tell them that charges were going to be filed, they were all very happy.
And then what about victims from the modern day cases? Have you also been in contact with them since you've made this arrest?
Yes, we have. We've kept in contact with our victims in the current cases on a regular basis. It's very important for us to do that.
Have you asked them at all if they could make a positive identification?
Captain, can you comment about have investigators reached out?
Can we give you guys a quick point of order? With respect to the modern-day cases, it's an open investigation. We can't discuss that. If you insist on asking the questions, we'll conclude the process.
Well, wait a minute. You're the guys that are having the high-profile news conference here.
I understand that. But
Can you talk there's a report out that investigators have reached out to police in Sacramento, California, about a series of unsolved rapes in that community in connection with this investigation?
Cannot comment on that right now.
Oh, you can't?
No, sir.
What can you tell us about what happened with him overnight in the jail? There was the incident overnight in the jail. Is he going to be held in solitary confinement from now on? And can you tell us a little more about what happened with him overnight?
I cannot talk about that right now. Next question.
I understood that he had grown a beard, perhaps in an attempt to conceal his identity. Can you confirm that he had a beard at the time you arrested him and that you shaved that in order to take a better look at whether he matched some of these indicators?
Cannot comment on that right now. Thank you.
That's the last question.
Thank you very much.
All All right, very good here. The police chief and prosecutor Jim Knatzer announcing a series of, I believe, 15 charges from cold cases dating over the winter of 1983 and 84, charging Bernard Jackson, 52-year-old man who was a person of interest in the latest round of Waldo rapes. All the rapes that are the cold cases are from the Waldo and Armor Hills area, and they're from 1983 and the winter lapping over into 1984.